Today for your garden, it's one of Linda Vodder's favorite things to do. What better way to enjoy the flowers and roses you grow than to take an armful to display in your home? So today we're talking about planning and preparing a cut flower garden. Linda's here. And how is a cut flower garden regular than, just how's it different than a regular garden?
Okay, well, let's use this as an example.
Okay.
So this beautiful bouquet of daffodils and tulips and these flowering branches, all of this grows in my garden.
Okay.
But the only thing I actually clipped from my garden were these beautiful branches.
Okay.
The others I bought from the grocery store.
Even though you've got them growing in your yard.
Because I don't want to denude the display that I have out front.
Oh.
I don't want to decrease the life. I don't want to detract from this beautiful, stunning floral display.
Right.
So I will buy what I'm already growing. However, that changes later in the season because I have in the back near my potager, I have a dedicated cut flower garden.
Fun.
And it's a great idea to have, particularly if you have a lot more space than those of us who, live in urban neighborhoods.
Right.
It's wonderful to have a dedicated area that is specifically for cut gardens.
Okay, you don't have a huge backyard. It's gorgeous, but it's not huge.
But it's not huge.
So how much space do you dedicate
regardless
to this?
Of size, here are the things you want to take into account. Number one, you want to make sure that it will get about 6 to 8 hours of full sun a day.
Okay.
Because really, most of the things that you're going to plant to bloom later in the summer need full sun. Secondly, you want it to be large enough so that you can space out the plants to make sure they get good, adequate air circulation to prevent problems like, fungal problems, powdery mildew, bug problems, things of that nature.
Okay.
And then you want to make sure that it's fairly well tilled. It doesn't have to be great soil, but you want to make sure that it's friable and has relatively good drainage.
Friable?
Friable. Loose, loamy soil.
Oh,
not unlike the texture of chocolate cake. So that when the seed germinates, it can put down those little, those little roots. So then let's go to some of the seeds that I like to, and that's another thing, I like to start them from seed.
Okay.
Because a lot of the things that I want to bring in as cut flowers are things that are easily started from seed.
Okay.
Okay. So zinnias are the classic cut flower.
Okay.
And the reason that I like them is, number one, they have long stems and they're long lasting in the vase. When you buy the seeds, however, make sure that you buy the long-stemmed variety and not the more, bushy types for landscape use.
How do you know it's long-stemmed?
Because it will tell you. It will tell you on the package how tall it will get.
Okay.
So zinnias are great. I also like sunflowers, but when you plant sunflower seeds, try to select a variety that will have multiple blooms on it.
Uh-huh.
Unlike those, the mammoth Russian that get huge, but it's a one-cut wonder. It only puts out one blossom. So look for plants that will put out multiple blooms on one plant.
And this is a dwarf sunspot.
And that's a dwarf sunspot. Then look at things that are a little bit less common, but that also make beautiful cut flowers.
Oh, yes. And
it's a trailing element.
You can eat these.
You can eat nasturtiums. And I love their peppery flavor. I love what they do in the vase. They're an unexpected, delicate addition to any kind of floral bouquet. If you buy them right now, you can go ahead and plant them. The seeds look like a large grape nut, and they have a very tough shell. So make sure that you soak them overnight, then put them in the ground, and they'll germinate much more quickly.
And as soon as they start doing, you can thank Linda Vodder for that. And you can enjoy more of her garden on her blog, potagerblog.com.